here in the IMUS in the Morning program. Richard Ben Cramer is the author of the bestseller Joe DiMaggio, The Hero's Life and What It Takes, which is one of my favorite books, Away to the White House. He's written for Rolling Stone, the New York Times Magazine, Time, Newsweek. In 1979, he won a Pulitzer Prize for his dispatches from the Middle East. He lives on Maryland's eastern shore with his wife and daughter. He doesn't write all that much, at least it appears to me. I was asking Charles, so I'm not clear how the guy makes a living, but maybe he's done well enough. Well, yeah, we'll find out.
Speculate he's done enough.
Now, Simon & Schuster has just published What Do You Think of Ted Williams Now? The Remembrance, by Mr. Ben Cramer, which I read yesterday afternoon and last night. So it's 115 pages, something like that. It includes this article that Mr. Cramer wrote back in 1986 for Esquire magazine, that became one of the premier pieces of sports writing journalism in the history of that craft.
Yep.
And is included in all of these collections of great sports writing and so on.
It's a piece of art.
Yeah. And Ted Williams retired, I believe. Well, let's find out. Good morning, Mr. Cramer. How are you?
I'm good, man. How are you doing?
What are you doing other than giving your cat emphysema?
Well, you know, I don't really get how you say I'm not writing that much. I'm working like a dog out here.
You are?
And I don't get enough books out the door for you.
Well, but let's go back to this. First, before we get to the meat of this book, what possessed you to pose for this idiotic picture, a holding a cigar with that poor cat? Jesus, what are you thinking about?
You know, it must be coincidence, but that cat did die.
Well, the cat, yeah. No, really? You're kidding. With the cigar stuck in his mush?
I didn't give him the cigar. He just happened to be around. I think he likes the smell.
Jesus, God. Anyway, my wife used to skip to school with her little IMUS in the Morning lunch pail. And, she used to run to school. This is how she wound up at Villanova on a track scholarship. And she loved Ted Williams. She's a big Red Sox fan.
She's got taste, I mean.
So, I don't know much about Ted Williams. And I, for example, here's how dumb I am. Until I read this book, this Esquire piece, I had no idea that he fished. I have no interest in fishing, but that's neither here nor there, but I guess he was as good a fisherman as he was a baseball player.
Yeah, to say Ted fished a little was to say, like, Picasso would sometimes paint. You know, he was probably the greatest fisherman that we had in the middle 20th century, especially flats fishing. He was one of the first guys who would go out on the Florida mangrove flats and fish with a fly rod, which is, you know, out there with a sea wind. Trying to throw a fly through that wind, you got to be a pretty big and powerful guy, and that was one of Ted's strengths. Of course, he was a precise, relentless fisherman, just as he was with hitting a baseball.
How big was he?
Well, he was. Geez, I think he was about 6'2" and a half, 6'3". And in his latter years, he was also thick. You know, when he came up, he was called the Splendid Splinter because he was just all bones. But, it was really the Army put the Marine Corps put the weight on him. And after that, he was a big, thick, powerful guy.
So where does he rank in terms of, you know, the pantheon of great baseball players?
Well, I think especially in the... since his death, people have come to maybe concede that Ted was the greatest hitter who ever lived. He, when he finished in 1960, he ranked third in home runs, just behind Babe Ruth and Jimmy Fox. But, you know, he did lose 5 years to two different wars. So you could say, you know, since they were prime years, that he very well may have hit as many home runs as Ruth had. He certainly hit for a higher average than any of his contemporaries. He finished, I think, with a .325 career average. And as an old hitter, he had to be the greatest that ever lived. He won batting titles like Barry Bonds has just done at the age, I think Ted was 39 when he won his last one. And he was throughout his time the most feared hitter in either league.
How many times did he hit over 400?
He only hit over 400 one time. That was in 1941, his third season.
Hit 406, right?
Yeah, he hit 406. It's a very famous story. On the last day of the season, he was at 399.5, and that would have been rounded up to 400.
Yeah.
And his manager asked him, did he want to sit it out and insure himself the 400 season that way? And Ted was just flabbergasted. He never even thought of sitting out. He went and played a doubleheader in Philadelphia and went 6-for-8 that day and ended up at 406.
It's 34 minutes past the hour. We're talking with Richard Ben Cramer, whose new book called What Do You Think of Ted Williams Now? Is just been published by Simon & Schuster and includes this fairly, well, it is a famous article that Mr. Cramer wrote for Esquire magazine in 1986. When did Williams retire?
He retired in 1960.
Okay. So then when you wrote this article, that was 26 years later.
Oh, yeah. He had long since been gone, and the point from a journalistic point of view was that he had made sure he was gone from the public eye. He didn't grant interviews. He didn't show up on the TV circuit. He didn't do any of that stuff.
And where did he lived in the Florida Keys, right?
He did at that time, yeah. Later he moved to Central Florida, kind of south of Orlando, a place called Citrus Hills, which was a development of a friend of his. Right. I think they gave him a free house.
So you went to, how did the assignment come up? Why did Esquire decide to do an article about Ted Williams 26 years after he'd retired?
Well, they were doing, you know how they used to do those special issues? This one was called The American Man.
Right.
And so, you know, they had a kind of dim feeling somewhere that Ted was the American Man, but they couldn't quite figure out why or how, and they of course couldn't ask him about it because he didn't take phone calls. So they sent me down there and, you know, patted me on the backside and said, good luck, boy. And, you know, several months later, I came back with the fish in my mouth.
So you were 35 at the time, right?
More or less, yeah.
So you showed up with a pack of camels. How'd that work out for you?
Well, Ted didn't like smoking. He was way ahead of his time on that. And not only did he not want anybody he knew to smoke, but he didn't want anybody around him to smoke. He was ahead of his time on that, too. So I used to go in his backyard and have a smoke when the urge would hit. But one day, I actually told this story in the book. One day, a phone rang, and he started cursing. He hated the phone. And I said, well, that's all right, Ted. You go ahead and take the call. I'm going out back to have a smoke, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, that's smoking. He said, that's the worst goddamn thing you can do. He said, how old are you anyway? And I told him, I said, I'm 35. He said, and look at you, losing your hair. Ted never just spoke to you. He always shouted in your face to make sure you were hearing him all right, you know.
Well, that had something to do with a war injury, didn't it? Or...
Well, you know, people used to say that. They used to say that the ear injury he suffered in Korea made him shout like that. I don't think that was it at all. If Ted wanted to speak quietly to one friend or some guy he knew, he could do that. He just wanted to make sure you were listening to him.
So what is a typical Red Sox fan? Maybe not fans. Well, I guess fans today. My wife's not that old, but I mean under 40. So, but what do they think? What's their perception of Ted Williams? Where does he?
Well, you know, in the months after his death, they all spoke of him in such reverent tones and said he was a god of the diamond and the great spirit of the Red Sox and everything. It made me laugh because they treated him so badly in Boston. You know, the Boston press is famous for its viciousness. And I think they really sharpened up their craft on Ted particularly. When he was a kid who barely got through high school in San Diego and then he came into this Boston thing. I think there were about six daily newspapers and they'd each send two or three games to the Red Sox because, you know, that was the only game in town in the summertime in Boston. And, geez, it was awful for Williams. I mean, they covered every every bit of the lowest common denominator stuff got in the paper. And, of course, he reacted badly because, you know, he felt it was his job to face them down. So it was a running war between them for 20 years, and the fans booed him, and Ted spat at the fans, and it was, you know, it was anything but a love fest.
Well, he was a great player, wasn't he?
He was a fabulous player.
Well, what were they all? Why were they on his case then?
Well, because it's Boston. They could, you know, no, Bremsky, they booed every one of their pitchers. If they ever get a pitcher who can win, he becomes, you know, like a political punching bag. It's just, I mean, that's the kind of town it is. They don't really like people who succeed.
Do you ever play in a World Series?
He played in one World Series and did very badly, and the Red Sox lost, of course, as they have every World Series since 1918. And of course, people booed Ted and blamed him for it.
Which World Series did he play in?
46. That year, Ted was voted by the AP voters nationwide as number two in a poll for flop of the year.
Oh, that's hideous. We're talking about Richard Ben Cramer's book, What Do You Think of Ted Williams? Now, I don't have a huge interest in, I mean, I'm a casual baseball fan, but I'm not ever going to go to Cooperstown or anything else, but I just love this book. Maybe it's because I like Cramer, but I mean, I like his writing, but I may like him too, but I read it yesterday afternoon when I got home, and then I finished it last night. It's a wonderful book, particularly, and what a fact, he's obviously one of those big enough, and a movie star, good looks, and a bigger than life figure. What did people like, you know, his contemporaries think of him? Like, say, for example, are you still smoking, by the way?
I smoke cigars now.
Jesus, when are you going to wake up? I mean, hello? Jesus, God. What a dope. Anyway. Now look at you. You're losing your hair. Anyway, what did Joe DiMaggio or people like that think of Hank Aaron, those kind of folks, or Mickey Mantle or Whitey Ford, or those people think of Rizzuto, those folks, Yogi, think of Williams?
Most of them loved him.
Because, well, they did.
Yeah, because Ted, you know, if you ask Ted a question about hitting, he'd talk to you for the next 6 hours. He'd try to tell you everything he knew. He was as generous a teacher as the game ever saw.
Well, anybody who notices whether a batter's box is sloped one way or another is taking their bats down to the post office to weigh them, is paying attention.
Yeah,
you know?
Ted was paying attention, and Ted wanted everybody else to pay attention. One of the reasons that you know, people thought he was such a character was because Ted wanted everybody to do it like he did. And, you know, there was Ted's way, and then there was the wrong way. Those were the two choices. And so, you know, he would get some kid, for instance, and start telling him how to hit and try to change the guy's stance and change his swing all in one day. Because, of course, Ted could just do it, so he thought everybody else could just do it.
Sure.
But the generosity of the man was, you know, I think it was famous throughout baseball. There was also, you know, he never made a show of this. He never wanted any credit or publicity about this. It would have embarrassed him, and it would have embarrassed the people he helped. But he also kept a lot of guys in business, like old guys who were too old to have qualified for baseball's pension or such. Ted would just send checks into their account. He wouldn't even tell them. He'd send, you know, 10 grand into their account, and they'd never even know what hit them.
Thought it was kind of clever the way he would call him up, pretending to raise money for the Jimmy Fund, which was his cancer fund for kids that he raised millions and millions of dollars for. And he would badger him into sending him a check for, he'd say, look, you son of a bitch, send me a check for $10. And the guy said, well, I'm having a kind of a hard time. He said, well, I called you, send me a check. So he'd get the check for $10, and he'd get their account number off of it. And then that's how he would deposit the number in their account, which I thought was a charming. So what did Joe DiMaggio, I read that book, but I didn't pay that close attention.
Yeah.
It wasn't what it takes for me. You understand what I'm saying?
I understand
that. Okay, anyway, what did Joe think of Ted?
Well, Joe never liked Ted. You know, Joe, f- first of all, he was terribly jealous that when people thought of hitting 400, they thought of Ted and not Joe. You know, Joe thought he always ought to have hit 400. And
did he ever hit 400?
No, but he was very close one year until he got an eye infection, and his manager wouldn't take him out of the lineup, and Joe regretted that the rest of his life. But, you know, he was also jealous of how easy Ted was in his own skin. You know, Ted said exactly what the hell he wanted, and Ted did what he wanted, and Ted was larger than life, and Joe... You know, I think Joe just couldn't stand it, that this guy was having all the fun that people imagined Joe had. Joe was kind of a miserable creature for most of his life. So they never really got along. Ted came to kind of understand Joe and laugh about him, but I don't think Joe ever got to laugh about Ted Williams.
Well, didn't DiMaggio say that Williams threw like a broad and ran like a duck?
Yeah, he used to say he throws like a broad and he runs like a ruptured duck. that was Joe, you know, a kind in every regard. But, you know, he couldn't stand that people would compare him to Williams because, of course, Joe thought he was three times the outfielder that Williams was, and all Williams could do was hit, which wasn't exactly true, but it certainly was what Ted paid attention to. Hitting was the part of the game Ted loved.
I got just a couple of minutes here, and I'll let you go. But what, when he died, and the kid's name's John Henry, is that the kid's
John
name?
Henry Williams, yeah.
And he wanted to freeze his dad, and so what? That I mean, I didn't...
Isn't that horrible?
I thought it was. I was out at the ranch, and we don't get a lot of news out there, but we got that news. I just thought that was... I don't know, I just...
Yeah, it's just something that goes against the grain of...
How did that happen?
Well, you know, the kid has always been trying to make his father into a business. He tried to make him into a website, which didn't work out too good, and he tried to sell all his fingernail clippings and everything else,
yeah,
you know.
God.
I mean, it's the grubbiest end of the business, and the kid is making a name for himself therein.
Well, the old man, Ted, had a couple of strokes, and the kid was living with him there in Florida, right? Making him sign stuff for hours every day?
That's right, yeah, according to the housekeeper.
What a bastard. Well, yeah. Where is Ted now? Is he still out there in the fridge?
He's hanging by his feet in a fridge somewhere.
Jesus.
That's just awful.
That's not good.
You know, the people in Boston now think that if they can unfreeze Ted, that they will finally lift the curse of the Bambino and maybe the Red Sox will win a World Series.
Oh, no, at the risk of patronizing, it's just a wonderful book.
Well, I'm glad you liked it. You know, you can't miss with Ted Williams because he was the real deal.
I don't care anything about baseball and less about fishing, and I love this book, so I don't know what that says, but we need some more stuff from you.
All right, well,
Richard?
I'll put down the smokes and start typing.
Well, I hope you're happy you killed your cat. So. All right, Richard, thank you.
All right, man. Have a good time.
You too. Richard Ben Cramer, it's called What Do You Think of Ted Williams Now? If I'll read this in an afternoon, it is a wonderful example of writing. God, you'd love this, Charles.
It is
a great account of the life of even somebody. I don't have that much interest in Ted Williams, but
sure.
I mean, it's a great piece of writing. It's a great story. And you fish, don't you?
Absolutely.
Don't you get out on that boat?
Yes,
and get drunk and fish?
He was a great fly fisherman.
But used to tie those flies, make them look like little bugs and so.
Well, let's continue this anti-mame after we...
Anyway, this is a great book. It's terrific. And I also, you probably think I'm crazy, but you at least should have it in your house. Stephen Jay Gould's The Structure of Evolutionary Theory, stick it on a coffee table there. It's like Stephen Hawking's book, remember, nobody ever read. It was a bestseller, but nobody read it, of course. This, you might, why don't you, you may not read it, but you should have it because it will go down with the works of Darwin and Freud and even Nut Aldous Huxley and some of those folks, which I used to read when I took acid. But it was a long time ago. All right, 12 to Leon.
One, two, three.
I'm a IMUS in the morning.